for the reading of the gospel. Today's gospel lesson is taken from Matthew chapter 13, verses 24 to 30 and 36 to 43. Jesus told them another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like a man who sowed good seed in his field. But while everyone was sleeping, his enemy came and sowed weeds amongst the wheat and went away. When the wheat sprouted and formed heads, then the weeds also appeared. The owner's servants came to him and said, "Sir, don't you sow good seed in your field? Where then did the weeds come from?" "An enemy did this," he replied. The servants asked him, "Do you want us to go and pull them up?" "No," he answered, "because while you are pulling the weeds, you may uproot the wheat with them. Let both grow together until the harvest. At that time, I will tell the harvesters, first collect the weeds and tie them in bundles to be burned. Then gather the wheat and bring it into my barn." Then he left the crowd and went into the house. His disciples came to him and said, "Explain to us the parable of the weeds in the field." He answered, "The one who sows the good seeds of the Son of Man, the field is the world, and the good seed stands for the people of the kingdom. The weeds are the people of the evil one, and the enemy who sowed them is the devil. The harvest is the end of the age, and the harvesters are angels. As the weeds are pulled up and burned in the fire, so it will be at the end of the age. The Son of Man will send out his angels, and they will weed out his kingdom, everything that causes sin, and all who do evil. They will throw them into the blazing furnace, where there will be a weeping and gnashing of teeth. Then the righteous will shine like the sun in the kingdom of their Father. Whoever has ears, let them hear." The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
You may be seated. We're going to take a look at the parable of Jesus today, and that highlights God's supreme patience over the world. Why is God patient? Because he wants no one to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 9. We're going to talk today about patience. So let's get started. You heard me read Matthew chapter 13, verse 24 to 30. What do you think this parable teaches us about the kingdom of God? What did Jesus' disciples understand it to mean? Apparently, they weren't really sure what it meant, because later, when Jesus left the crowd and went into the house, the disciples asked him to explain it. Jesus was happy to explain the parable to them because he wants them to understand the kingdom of God and the resurrected Christ, the one we interact with today through prayer and the Holy Spirit. It also is eager to explain things to us in order to broaden our knowledge and understanding so that our lives become more godly. At first glance, this parable seems straightforward. Do good guys go to heaven and the bad guys get thrown into the fire? Let's take a closer look, because what Jesus is teaching in this parable is far more challenging than that. And this is not a parable about some future day of judgment as much as it is a parable about God's patience and how we can live our lives today. So let's do a quick review for understanding. Who is the farmer who sowed the good seed? Jesus. Who does the good seed represent? The people of the kingdom. do the weeds represent? The people of the evil one. Who is the enemy who sows the bad seed? The devil. Does the farmer pull weeds, or does he let them grow alongside the wheat until harvest? He lets them grow until harvest. Okay, see, that quiz was real easy. You got all the answers right. So you passed. Now let's take a look. I want to give two background notes to this passage. First, it's important that we dig deeper into verse 38. The New International Version translates the Greek as the people of the kingdom, the people of the evil one. The New International Version is using inclusive language here that might dilute the original meaning a bit. I want to make sure we get back to the original meaning because it helps us better understand what Jesus is teaching. The Greek word, wihoi, which means sons, sometimes is translated as children. But the idea is a descendant of a particular person. The English Standard Version of the Bible translates the verse like this: the good seed are the sons of the kingdom. The weeds are sons of the evil one. The New King James Version of the Bible says this: the good seed are the sons of the kingdom, but the tares, the weeds, are the sons of the wicked one. The English Standard Version and the New King James Version have more accurate translation of wioi than the New International Version. We use the NIV, the New International Version that we read this morning. Jesus is talking about children of God or children of the devil, whether they be male or female. The idea is a descendant from the lineage of a particular person. We'll come back to this in a minute. Let's look at the second background note. It's about the weeds. The weeds mentioned are commonly believed to be darnel. Darnel is a weed-like grass that looks a lot like wheat in its early stages of growth, making it difficult to distinguish from the wheat. But even though darnel looks like wheat, it's actually very toxic to wheat because it can affect the quality and the yield of the harvest. And more interesting, darnel is toxic to humans. Jesus is saying the kingdom of God is not pure kingdom on this side of heaven. There will be authentic followers of Jesus, the good seed, mixed in with the coexisting with the toxic imposters who aren't the real thing, the bad seed. I want you to say again that this parable is not about the future. It's about today, the here and the now. It would be easy to read this parable and simply let it reinforce our existing beliefs about the end times and judgment day. The good guys get to heaven. The bad guys go to the fire. That's the safe way to interpret scripture. To read our existing beliefs and to rather let them speak to us afresh. There's much more here that relates to today than there is about the future harvest and the day of judgment. Jesus' explanation of the parable is disturbing. He says the good seed, the wheat, represents the children of God, while the weeds are the bad seed, which represents the children of the devil. Here's an important question. How does Jesus define a child of God? How Jesus defined a child of the devil. I wonder if Jesus' definitions might differ from our own. That's why this parable is disturbing. Let's look at John chapter 8, where Jesus is having a back and forth with the Pharisees and religious leaders. When Jesus puts them on the spot and challenges their paternity, he challenges whether they are children of God or children of the devil. John chapter 8, verse 39 to 47 reads, "Abraham is our father," they answered. "If you were Abraham's children," said Jesus, "then would you do what Abraham did? As it is, you are looking for a way to kill me, a man who has told you that the truth that I heard from God. Abraham did not do such things. You are doing the works of your own father. You are not illegitimate children," they protested. "The only father we have is God himself." Jesus said to them, "If God were your father, you would love me, for I have come here from God and have not come on my own. God sent me. You belong to the Father, the devil, and you want to carry out your father's desires. He was a murderer from the beginning, not holding to the truth, for there is no truth in him. When he lies, he speaks his native language, for he is a liar and the father of lies." Do you see Jesus' definition? A child of the devil is someone who imitates the devil. What does the devil do? He lies, he kills, he steals, and he destroys. What were the Pharisees and religious leaders doing in John 8? They were spreading false rumors about Jesus. They were lying. They were plotting to kill him. They were doing exactly what the devil would do. So Jesus declared them children of the devil. Jesus rejected their claims that Abraham was their father because they were acting in ways contrary to Abraham. Abraham followed God wholeheartedly through faith. To be clear, Jesus didn't mean they were literally biological children of the devil. They were simply living the devil's image because they were doing what the devil did. They were imitating the devil with their attitudes and their actions. In Jesus' definition, a child of God is someone who imitates God. A child of the devil is someone who imitates the devil. This is very important. In the parable of the weeds, Jesus is saying the good seed, the children of God, are the people who imitate God. And Jesus' standard, that's his expectation and his definition. Jesus is emphasizing practice of faith over confession of faith. Even the Pharisees confessed the right words. They had the right confession of faith, they shouted. The only father we have is God himself. But that carried no weight with Jesus because they weren't imitating God. They weren't obeying God and loving others. Since they were not imitating God, they were not children of God. They were doing what the devil does. And therefore, they were children of the devil. It's not that what we confess, it's who we imitate that determines whether or not we're children of God or children of the devil. Imitating God is an important theme to Jesus. In Matthew chapter 5, verse 43 to 45, it says, "You have heard that it was said, love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, that they may be children of your Father in heaven and cause his sun to rise on the evil and the good and sends rain on the righteous and the unrighteous. Why are we to love our enemies? Because God loves his enemies. God sends rain on the righteous and on the unrighteous. If God loves his enemies, we will love our enemies because we are imitators of God. God loves his enemies and reconciles them for himself on the cross. We are to love them the same way. And when we do, we are children of God. That's what Jesus is saying. In the Beatitude, Jesus teaches, blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Why are peacemakers called children of God? Because God himself is a peacemaker. If we do what God does, we will be called his disciples, his children. How is God a peacemaker? In Colossians chapter 1, verse 19 to 20, it says, for God was pleased to have all his fullness dwell in him, and through him to reconcile to himself all things. Were things on earth or things in heaven, by making peace through his blood shed on the cross. God is a peacemaker, and those of us who are peacemakers will be called children of God. God does not expect us to be perfect. He is moving us towards perfection, but that might take a few billion years. Don't quit or be too hard on yourselves. He helps us develop a pattern of practice of good things that we should be consistently doing. Consistently loving others. Whenever you imitate your father, if you lie, steal, kill, or destroy, you are a child of the devil. If you love, forgive, extend kindness, and endure hardship, all things the Father does, you are children of God. It's a parable about imitation, not a confession of faith. A child does what their father does, the way you live your life, not what you profess to believe, but how you demonstrate and how you live. Let me ask you again, who do you imitate? God is patient for the harvest. Is that who you imitate? God? God is extremely patient. Are you extremely patient? That gives us something to work for, doesn't it? Are you in a rush to pull the darnel, the weeds that denies the wheat to have all its strength? He says, let them grow together until the harvest, and then we'll sort it out. When we have a garden grown, how many of us are out there pulling the weeds instead of waiting till the right time? Why is God patient with us? Because he wants no one to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. He wants everyone to imitate him and turn away from the devil. He wants you to find a better way to live. He wants those trapped in darkness to find the light. He wants those who have no hope to hear the gospel, understand it, and come into true life. That's why God is patient. And God is a God of miracles. He can turn water into wine. He can multiply bread and fish. And who is to say he cannot turn darnel weeds into authentic plants of wheat? Anything is possible with God. A child of the devil today can become a child of God tomorrow. This is where the hope comes in, the hope of the gospel. Are we going to take that hope? If you're a Christian, are you intentionally imitating Jesus? The Christian life goes beyond a simple confession of faith with words and moves into the intentional lifestyle of living like Jesus. Will you patiently endure the attitudes and actions of those around you who are imitating the devil? Can you leave today with an expected hope that God might actually show up and do a miracle of changing weeds into wheat? It's possible. You know that. Amen.